bring it in, bring it in. My man, Frank Rob, how you doing today?
Well, doing good, man. Excited about the podcast today. It's going to be a very good one. You know, everything's smooth here, bro. So how's it going for you?
Man, it's going good, man. I got some bad news, man, from a friend of mine who had a kid in a college program, and they took him to the school for this upcoming season, and things didn't turn out the way they wanted to. So, like, the communication was kind of bad, and basically the kid was supposed to get a full scholarship but ended up not getting it, and he found out about it after returning to the school, which was kind of a bad situation, man. Very bad situation.
Wow.
Yeah, so, like, we want to remind the parents out there to make sure you communicate all the way through, you know, get it on paper, everything, especially when you're talking about programs, different programs, D1, D2, D3, NAIA, stuff like that. Make sure you get that on paper and verbally talk to these coaches and understand, like, if they say that you have a full scholarship, make sure they back that up. But let's go ahead and get into the podcast today. We have a very, very, very special guest. We have Miss Tracy, Coach Tracy Dacosta from Creekside High School. She is a 3-time Coach of the Year from Dairy Farms, man, which is a very prestigious company in Jacksonville, which gives out, in Florida, which gives out awards to different sporting groups all throughout the state. So that's a big time thing. How you doing, Tracy? Coach Tracy?
I'm doing great, to see me.
All right. We really appreciate you being on the show, and we're going to be talking about swimming. So it's going to be the first time on the show that we talk about swimming. So we love for you to enlighten us on this subject. So we really, really appreciate you being on the show.
Awesome. I love talking about my favorite sport.
Awesome. So let's go ahead and dive into it. Let's get to know you. Let's get to know you. Just how did you become a swimming coach, and just, you know, your youth and stuff like that?
Well, you know, first off, as a kid, I, you know, did a lot of different sports, and I just had a passion for swimming. And what takes me in a different direction now as a coach is when I was in Baltimore, Maryland, you know, home of Michael Phelps and Katie Ledecky, you know, big swim programs there. My high school that I attended did not have a high school swim program. So I had to swim for, like, a year-round group, you know, which is, we have a lot of that here up in Northeast Florida. So the experience that I present to my athletes is kind of the one I didn't have. I did have my high school pride and my high school team that I could have swam for. I just had to do it on my own as an individual swimmer. And from there, you know, I didn't go to college out for swimming. I honestly started to lose passion, like everybody does with their sports. They have their highs and their lows.
Mm-hmm.
And I started looking into other sides of it and fell right back into love. I started, you know, coaching. I started, you know, teaching swim lessons. Doing privates on the side, and just really seeing that I had a knack for coaching. I had a knack of getting these kids passionate about the sport and just really connecting with each other as a team. That's one of my biggest philosophies, is bringing the team aspect to this individual side of it. And so I've been coaching here in Northeast Florida for 15 years in high school swimming. I've coached swimming for 18 years, athletes anywhere from like ages 3 through 18. So, kind of getting up there in my experience.
Oh yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah.
So what would you say to a parent that has a young child that loves the water and loves swimming? What would you say some first things to start out as? Like, because, you know, you can't start out in high school, so you would have to start out before high school. So what would you advise them to start out as to first start learning how to swim and to compete, maybe?
Normally the first, you know, like I said, I'm originally from up north and live down here in Chaffanel. Normally the first thing you look for is a summer program. A lot of YMCAs have summer programs, private clubs, and you don't exactly have to be a member of the club for your child to swim on the athletic program. I worked for a program in South Carolina in Charleston for a while. So the recreation center there offered it. A lot of colleges offer summer rec programs. That's a good launching point because the kids are going to see daily. They have to have practices. You'll see their ability improve. from there is when they can jump into that commitment level of being on a year-round swimming team. When they get into year-round, like I said, I'm a big advocate of an athlete being an athlete. Okay. Not focusing at too much of a young age on one sport.
Okay.
But trying different mm-hmm. things out. So you want, you know, I always feel like you want to find a program that's going to keep you in the water 2 to 3 days a week, you know, and I'm talking about like kids that are like, you know, elementary, middle school age in there, you know, something that you're 2 to 3 days a week, but then you're still able to do soccer or track or basketball. And then as you get into high school, that's when you start to see your focus. That's when you're really starting to go, I like this, I don't like this. And that's where the kids really need to start honing in on that commitment level. Is after reaching that high school peak. And you really get to see if you have a talent for the sport or not. And, you know, ultimately you have to have a passion for it. You have to, as a parent and as a swimmer, be ready to wake up early in the morning, be ready to be at the pool till, you know, 7 to 9 o'clock at night practicing. And love the smell of chlorine. Your car will smell like it a lot.
I hate you. So, before the high school level, are there any websites or that can tell you like the top programs in the country? Are there any like, you know, AAU or national swimming websites that you can compete against some of the top level swimmers in your age group?
The number one source is usaswimming.org. If you go onto their website, that is the national swimming site for all the rules for the whole sport. And they have a search area in there where you can type in your city, your location, and it will pop up with all the licensed swim programs that are in the area. Now, most programs all run through USA Swimming. The, like I said earlier, the YMCA also has its own program. So you can go to a YMCA site, and YMCA programs mainly swim against other YMCA programs.
Okay.
And then if the athletes qualify with a certain time, then they cross over into some of the USA swimming meets too. So both of those are great sources of information and seeing what kind of programs are in your area. And from there, it gives you the websites that you can reach out to those different programs. And most programs will give you a trial period. Depending on it, I've seen programs that will give a week trial up to 2 weeks where your child can come to their practices, see what the practices are like, see what the coaches and their expectations are before giving the full commitment to the program, which is great because you have to have a connection with that coach. They have to have the same vision as you before you, you know, spend all that time with them and honing your skill.
Because I have a question for you. When it comes to swimming, me, myself, and Randy is also, we both are military guys that were in the branch of service that require a lot of discipline, sometimes ungodly amount of discipline, in my opinion. Does that apply to swimming as well? It looks like it does because you have to have the perfect technique, perfect form. You got to be disciplined in everything you do. How big is that in swimming? So people would know that it's going to require more than just, you know, the physical or the athleticism to get it done. You're also going to have to be disciplined. How big is being disciplined into becoming one of the best, if not the best, swimmers in the world?
I mean, specifically in high school, a lot of it is your external influences you're going to have. I mean, you have things as easy as the weather. Again, here in Florida, like, it's great right now. It's nice and hot out, but some of the pool water temperatures can be too warm. You need to be ready to get in the water. And then when we hit about October and November, because our season's earlier in the year, once we're in October, November, even though we're Florida, it gets kind of chilly here.
Yes.
So, you know, mm-hmm. being able to get in the water, being able to, you know, do your workout, you know, there's safety requirements of, you know, what the water temperature has to be. But I've had athletes come from Wisconsin and Michigan, and most of those facilities are indoor facilities. You take that external of the air versus water temperature, you know, getting your motivation in the morning. And, you know, you have to be a certain type of individual because there's only 4 strokes. It's not like football where you have a multitude of positions, you know, to start learning or playing or, you know, baseball, softball, you know, maybe you go from pitching, mm-hmm. you go to first base or third base. Assuming you have 4 strokes. So your freestyle, your backstroke, your butterfly or your breaststroke.
Okay.
And a really skilled athlete can do all 4. But it's that going back every day, knowing that you have an imperfection in your stroke. and being able to work every day over and over and over again on imperfection. One of the top swimmers we're seeing come out right now, Caleb Dressel, from this area too, Clay County. You know, I've seen him compete. Our high school competed against him when he was back in high school, swam for gold, mm-hmm. then swam for University of Florida. That's one of his training methods that it's been written about in a lot of different articles, is breaking down your individual swim, your individual stroke, what did you accomplish that day, and having the discipline to say to yourself, I wasn't perfect, and here's what I need to fix. And it's always seeking that perfection. You've got to have that strong discipline. You have to have that strong-willed mind to just keep going after it day after day after day. And especially in the high school atmosphere where you're seeing your friends, you know, going out on a Friday night, and you know you've got practice at 7 a.m. Or for my athletes, they practice at 5:30 a.m. So there's a strong discipline of getting their homework done, getting to bed, because they got to be up early on that So, you know, it's a lot of pressure for these high school athletes. A lot of them are looking to go into college programs. And, you know, in Florida, there's not as many men's programs in swimming. There's a lot more nationwide. So they have to be constantly disciplined of, I'm going to get up, I'm going to do my workout, I'm going to listen to my coach. This is what they're telling me that's wrong with my stroke. And being able to mentally, you know, fix it. You know, day after day after day, keep their mind in it that I'm fixing this part of my technique, this part of my routine to make me a stronger athlete.
My daughter does track, and it's kind of weird. Okay. So I just want to know, is it the same concept in swimming? I know our track coaches don't do this, but my track coach does this. So he never lets her run her event. She either runs past her event, shorter than her event, or whatever, but he doesn't let her run her event like on a daily time period. And I'm like, I don't understand why you do that. Like, it's just really hard for me to fathom, to understand. Do y'all do that? Do you, like, when you practice, do you run your event, or do you do just a certain amount of different time lengths in the pool?
So if we're talking about our daily practices, yeah, you never run the distance that you're actually competing. We'll either run 25 yards shorter than it, or we will swim, you know, 2 to 3 times longer than it. You don't want to have a set that too much distance, because then they're not working at the correct pace that they need to be swimming at. And you don't want to do anything that's too fast, because then they're not going to have that aerobic energy, you know, built into your body to last for the distance you want to do. So it is finding that right middle ground and practicing it off and on each day. So we'll have days that are more endurance, more long distance driven, and other days that are more sprint than the short distance, and working, you know, the different strokes versus just being the majority of freestyle. Then for competition with my athletes, the way my coaching philosophy is, when we go to dual meet, so we're more just going against one team, my athletes might swim one of their events, like their main events, one of the things they're going to state in, and then we swim an off event. Because as an adolescent body changes, there's going to be a lot of growth and development. So you might not be a butterflyer when you're a freshman, but by the time you're a senior, you know, you've bulked up, you've become wide, you've built all of your abs and your glutes and your thighs and your biceps, and everything has, you know, built so much strength that you can conquer those harder events at a faster speed. So I always tell the kids, you can't settle in and say, I'm a this. Because as your body changes, you need to be prepared to change in the distance or the events that you're going to compete in.
We always
try to keep that window open.
I really appreciate that, because my coach, he teaches he teaches track at Creekside, so hopefully he listened to this, and I can tell him.
Really?
Yeah, I can tell him. Okay. You explained it way, way better than he did, so I really appreciate it. Before we go too far into this, how expensive is swimming on the, you know, the youth level before high school, like local and just a little bit outside of Jacksonville, you know, Orlando, stuff like that? How expensive is that?
Well, okay, so if you're talking about you know, if you're in year-round program, you're going to have a monthly fee that you have to pay to the program, which is going to run you anywhere like $140 to $200, depending on which program you go to.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, then, depending on that program, is all the swag that you need to buy. You know, certain programs, you need to have a practice suit. Other programs are just, you know, you're there in a bathing suit, you're going to practice. The biggest expense that comes into swimmers is one, when you get in that more elite area, there's higher swim meets. The kids are all wearing the tech suits. These suits, only you can wear them only 4 to 5 swim meets total.
Whoa.
Before the materials start to kind of give away. And these suits are, on average, about $250. And it's kind of like a compression, you know, so when you run and you wear some fresh stuff, that's what's really doing to your body.
Mm-hmm.
And it helps, especially in the hips area, it helps lift the body. It helps get you through the water. It doesn't absorb as much water. So to get faster. And those suits, like I said, 4 to 5 wears, $250 a pop. So a swimmer will purchase one, let's say, in high school season, they'll get about 3 to 4 wears out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're going to buy a brand new one for their year-round swimming program as they get to those elite meets, you know, that happen either in March or in August. And then, of course, travel. You know, everybody's got their travel fees, hotels and your meet fees. And so when you have that baseline of $140, depending on the program, the parents, it's not like your monthly bill is $140, because then you're going to have the add-on of your child going to a certain meet. I've had parents who have had bills, you know, around $300 for 1 month because their swimmers have competed in, you know, certain swim meets, and they have to pay per swim event that they're competing in.
But the thing, like, let me say this right quick before you jump in, Frank Rob. But the thing we got to remind our parents is any sport you go into is going to cost. But when you do everything you have to do academically, you do everything you have to do athletically to get yourself to a certain level, you would not pay the same that you would pay for college, and you will not have student loans. So it is worth it. Go ahead, Frankie Rob. Go ahead, Frankie Rob.
Well, we all love and seeing a smile on our kids' face too. So I mean, there's also that. You know, it's like instead of buying them the video game, you're having them being athletic in
true,
the sport.
True.
And
true.
I'd much rather see my child being outside doing something than just sitting inside some days.
True, true. Good one. That's a good one. Go ahead, Frank.
All right, Coach. So I got a question for you. So basically, when you said something about the more athletic meets, are those things that you get? I know the only thing I know right now is football. So I'm happy you're on the show to enlighten me because I got smaller kids that could actually do, you know, swimming or whatever. But, you know, when you said that you get those elite meets, is that something that you're selected for, or anybody can sign up to do those?
For some meets for high school, we actually have to do tryouts. You know, every year we have a tryout program for our program. And it depends on the year. I know ourselves, Bartram down the road, had my roster consists of 25 boys, 25 girls at the spots that I can allow in. And that's limited because of our pool space. We have 6 lanes that we practice in. Our boys and girls practice together at 5:30 in the morning to 7:30. So I'm kind of doing the math. We're packed in 8 to 9 kids in a lane. So like if you're running track and if you had 8 kids who had to run just in that one lane, that's kind of what we're doing. So we're limited on the athletes who can do it. And, you know, fortunately in this area, we have a lot of kids who are interested in sports. So the unfortunate side, the side that we don't like seeing is, you know, we do need to make cuts. So after we make cuts, then the kids have a fit requirement for practice. I'm one of those coaches that even if they're swimming year-round, they're part of our team. They're part of our high school team. They're representing our high school. They need to be united as a team. So I've got kids at 4 different year-round programs that I've got to bring together to be a team, to trust in each other, to work on their relays, you know, to get all their timing right. And nothing beats, any sport can say this, you always have the jokes. And nothing beats, be it if you're in the locker room, be it if you're in your swim lane, you know, you're on deck, there's always the jokes or the things that happen that bond you as a team. And that's what I say to them. I'm like, if you're not here, you're not getting that friendship with your friends. You know, you're not getting to know your teammates. So that's what makes them be there to meet. Depending on the meet we're going to, I'll get the feedback from the kids of what event they want to swim, especially when I look at my juniors and seniors, and if they're looking for recruitment. Some colleges want the kids to have certain times and certain events, so, you know, I'll let them keep doing those events. You know, I kind of keep that open door policy. You know, you talk to me, see what direction we need to go into, I'll try to put you in those events. But we're limited. We can only put 4 kids in an event.
Okay.
In high school. So, again, kind of similar there about the track. It's not like I can throw everybody in a 100 freestyle. I can only have four kids compete in the 100 freestyle. So it's going, am I going to put in my four fastest, or am I going to put in my three fastest, give somebody a chance to get a better time? There's a
strategy to it.
A lot of people don't think it. They just want to put the fastest in. And
I was like,
sometimes you got to weigh different options and look at different things.
So, all right. So, let's jump into that. So, all right, I'm looking right here at the NCAA website. It's saying that for swimming D1 team, they can only give out 14 full scholarships. So, this is the big question that a lot of people want to know. How many kids are on a woman swimming team? For Division
One? It depends on the coach. Okay. It depends on the coach. I know.
I'm talking about for college.
Yeah, no, I understand from college.
Okay.
I know one program, out in Western Florida. They had one coach and turned over to another coach the following year, and they had so many commitments that not everyone was getting shot to swim, and they kind of were spending all their money on the sophomores, the juniors, the seniors they had. So when this new coach came in, he couldn't really offer any of the freshmen money. He had to wait till the juniors and seniors from the previous coach graduated off, and then he would have money to offer the incoming freshmen. It depends on the program. UF is very limited sometimes because they again, same thing. They're going to have the superstars that they're spending the money on. Sometimes you have to be prepared to be committed and not receive a scholarship for 1 or 2 years. Whoa. And then they have the money for you.
Okay.
Some are just going to redshirt you as a freshman, like what we use the term for football. They're going to redshirt you. You're not going to get any playing time. You're not going to be any of these swim meets, but you're still expected to be at all the meets and be there at all the practices, just like a team member. So each program varies. I mean, like I said, the one program, I've seen them as high as having, 30 to 50 girls on their roster.
Mm.
But that doesn't mean 30 to 50 are swimming. And I've seen other programs who like to be more tight-knit, and they'll usually only have, again, 25, 30, 35 if you count your divers. But they keep the number lower versus higher.
So,
depends on the money the program has.
I got you. So I see on here also it has the times for the different events. So, like for a 50 free, it has a time of I don't know, it's 25 or lower or greater or something like that. So my thing is, so if what's better to be a master of one or just good at all four of those type of styles? Which one's better for a college school?
Your number one thing, and I tell my athletes who are really looking to swim in college, the number one event most of them are going to look at is 2IM. So in that race, you're doing, two laps, so 50 yards of each stroke. Everybody knows you're going to usually have a weaker stroke than the other three, but they want to find somebody who has that strong depth in all four strokes. From there, if you're not an IM or if you're not strong in the four strokes, you better have two that you're really good at.
Really good.
We recently had a boy recruited out to FSU. Phenomenal freestyler. He won state in 100 freestyle. But as he was going through that recruitment process, his coach was saying, you can't be just that one shot. I need you for another event. I need to, they want to get their money out of you.
Oh, definitely. Oh, we talk about that all the time.
He had to work and develop on another stroke, which ended up being backstroke for him. But he had to constantly work on having, a second stroke to be able to show him. And then the other thing they separate them is the sprinters and the distance. If you're a distance swimmer, if you can swim, to 200, to 500, there's a lot of offers there because when they're swimming those distances, they're swimming them fast. They are very fast races. And so, that's where a lot of the money is, because if you can swim fast in the long distance, it's easy to take you down sometimes to be a sprinter. But it's very hard to take a sprinter and move them up the long distance. Here again, like as track or cross country would know, it doesn't always correlate, one to the other.
Okay. Okay. Yes, sir. So what about measurables compared to like other sports? So like, and let me give you an instance. You probably already know because you sound like you'd be a good football coach. Tell you the truth, with some of your concepts that you say, you sound like you're a very good football coach. But so in football, college coaches, they come to the different schools. They see kids that are like, you know, 6'3" with a 6'6" wingspan that really can't even play football that well, but they think they can turn them into that next level athlete. It's the same thing with swimming. It's like, so if a person runs a good time, but they're shorter, you know, their body type is not set yet. Does that mean anything?
No, it doesn't mean anything. I mean, I've had, you know, here again, talking about my program, specifically even into recruitment, mm-hmm. we've had kids who have had state titles. One of them, he was about probably 5'6", short guy, mm-hmm. you know, he was very strong, muscular. And then, you know, the other swimmer I was talking about last year, you know, he was well over 6 foot tall, but his body mass was not there as much on the muscle side. Both of them, you know, got recruited into college, both have swim college, and, it, you know, one, it depends on the event, but the number one thing is just depends on their physiology of their body and what they're able to put out. And again, your distance swimmers usually going to be taller and leaner, okay. but not always, and same thing, your sprinters, usually they are, you know, shorter, but again, not always. It's you can look at a swimmer and you can, you know, have the old wives' tale of, you know, oh, they're going to be this type of swimmer, that type of swimmer, but you, there's always the kids who break the mold. You know, there's always the ones that you look and you're surprised that they're able to do what they can do.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So just give us a little bit of your program, just to let, you know, our Daddy's Ball listeners understand, you know, talk about some of your kids, talk about a lot, you have a lot of accomplishments, talk about that. Just give us a little bit of that before we jump into our parent guest that has some questions.
Yeah, so we're a fairly, you know, new high school in the state of Florida. We are entering into our 12th year. We have had 3 state titles. We have the school's first state title in 2014 with our boys program, and then we've been back-to-back with the girls program with having state wins. In addition to that, we've won girls medley relay, has won state title 3 years. We've had about 8 individual state title winners at our school, and we've had another 2 other boys state title winning relays. So we've made it to state ever since our first year. First year, I brought 2 kids to state, and now I'm averaging, last year when I was at state, I had a kid at every single event. every single swimming event, I'll put it that way. There's 24 events in high school swimming when you count diving. So we were in 22 because we didn't have any divers reaching at the state level. But we did have a state, 2 state divers, a male and a female in the past, who's made it into top 8. And we currently this year, most of our program last year was all freshman, sophomore driven. We did have 1 senior who was in the top 8, and on 2 of our state runner-up relays, she is at Rice now. She had a recruitment offer and is swimming right now at Rice University. Awesome. But everybody else was young. They're all coming back, so they're all sophomores and juniors this year. So we have strong depth in our female program. And same thing with our boys. We're very heavy with juniors and seniors and boys this year. So, you know, we're really looking for a strong season this year. Plus, we've had 2 kids move from Wisconsin, and one of them, she was the state champion diver for the state of Wisconsin, and they've moved here to Florida. So she's diving for us. That was a great addition to hear that. So, which plays into points when we go into state this year. So we moved up in classification. We're in the highest classification. Buholtz out of Gainesville had won the girls' state championship the past 4 years, but the majority of their girls just graduated off this past year. They were all seniors. They were very strong, talented girls, swimmers. But my girls are hungry for it. We have the depth in numbers. That's what we go for. We don't have, like, that number one star. We have 18 talented females. That's we can use in a lot of different events and sweep a lot of points. And so that's what we're looking for this year.
Okay. So compared to Bose, you know, Bose has the, I think they have like international players and stuff like that. Are y'all on the same level as far as competing as them for state?
No. So in the state of Florida, the FHSA, which is, you know, our association that oversees our program, they break up the classification based on the population of schools.
Oh.
And I'm going to probably be totally off on this, but, you know, like how football, I know at least of 8, 9, maybe 10A. I'm not quite familiar how high it's gone to now.
It's 8. It's
but
eight.
In swimming, we're up, we're up to 4. So there's 4 levels of swimming, and it's based on your school population. So Falls, they're in Class 1A because they're a private school, and their high school enrollment numbers are, you know, under, you know, right around 1,500. This year has been a big shakeup going into this year. Creekside, Bartram, Nice, we're all topping over 2,500 students at our high school. So we're competing against Mandarin. Atlantic Coast has also moved up with us. And then schools that are notoriously big, Fletcher, have moved down. They moved down to the Class 3A. So it doesn't have anything to do with, not like what you see what's going on with basketball and baseball, where it's based on your win record. It's still just based on your school population number. So we always do, there's a program in the Swim Network here in Florida. They always do this virtual swim meet. And so after everybody's done the state meet, they take all the times and put all the teams together. So they always do, you know, this virtual meet, like as if we swam against Bowles and as if we swam against, you know, the Duholtz or Oviedo and these other schools that are further south, even though they're in a different classification. That's always fun to look at. I do have some of my athletes do swim for Bowles year-round. That's your year-round program, as well as the year-round programs here in Joliet Creek that they swim for. But, you know, like you said, Bowles does have the option of having, because it's a private school, they have room and board. So they do have some kids who are from out of the country, who do swim for them from time to time. And a lot of international students who parents move to the area for the years that they're going to be in high school.
Yes.
So when they go to the Olympics, that's why you're seeing full students at Joseph Schooling who represented Singapore. You know, we just had a swimmer represent Canada as well as the USA and Guam and a lot of these, Spain is another country. You see them represent, these Bowles alumni represented in a lot of these different areas because they went to school here and they may have dual citizenship with their parents. That plays into, you know, when you look at the Olympics, we have a swimmer who's a freshman for us who could compete for, the Canadian Olympic team. He has the qualifying times right now as a 14-year-old. So it's it's interesting how that happens in the sport of swimming, when it's an Olympic sport like that, of, you know, where you can fit in.
That's awesome. So we got like, I got one more question before we call our guest that wanted to talk to you about just some help in recruiting process. The last question I got, you got anything, Frank Rock?
Nah, man, I'm blown away from, you know, how this thing actually goes. I'm like, I'm happy to talk to you.
Yes.
Happy to talk to you, Coach. Happy to hear it.
It's very, very, very special. But I got one more question. So my last question is to understand the basis of club team versus high school. All right, so those, a lot of time, those are different coaches, you know, with different philosophies and stuff like that. But my thing is, which one, I know everything's different, but which one do the college coaches go to the most? Because in basketball, they go to the AAU coaches because they can see all the kids at one time. They don't really come to the high school coaches unless you're on an elite program. So how is that in swimming?
The majority of them, will go to the year-round coaches first because that's where there's a more variety of events that the swimmers can compete in U.S. Swimming versus what they're doing in high school swimming. However, you know, for the peak season for girls, it's usually the late junior year, and then for the boys, it's right now in the fall. they like to see, we go to a couple invitational meets, and it is not uncommon. We go to one at the end of September. There's always a ton of college coaches there. And definitely when you get to the state meets, there's usually at least 10 to 20 different college coaches there at the state meet. As soon as your athlete's done competing, you know, calling over and trying to ask and talk to you. I've had a couple college coaches reach out to me, you know, time to time, and usually it's to ask also, you know, who their year-round program is and to know about the athlete and their mm-hmm. work habits.
Okay.
Just that, there's one thing of being an individual, but it's another thing to be part of a team. And when you go to college, you're having to be that team athlete. So they need to make sure that you can put that side of your ego, you know, aside and still be there for your team and still perform for that team aspect of what the coach asks you to do.
Okay. All right, so let's go ahead and get into this second part of our podcast where we're going to call a parent. She lives in Orlando. I don't want to butcher her name, so I'm going to let her say it first. I just do not want to butcher it on recording. So I'm going to give her a call. And basically, like I said, her daughter runs. She swims for the Junior Olympics. But we're going to find out a little bit about that. And she's just trying to get just another thought process on just the recruiting process to help her out. You know, so anything you can do, just definitely help out. So let's give her a call.
Okay.
All right.
Hello.
Hello, this is Randy from Daddy's Ball Podcast. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing great. So I got my co-host Frankie Robb on the line. What's up, Frankie Rob? Talk to us. Say hello.
How you doing there?
And
good. How are you?
I have the
coach. Doing good.
Also, I had a coach from Creekside High School. Her name is Tracy Dacosta, and she's very knowledgeable about the recruiting process. So I just wanted, because you know, Alonzo reached out to you, and he told me about, you know, your daughter and stuff like that, and I thought it'd be very, very interesting to have all of us on the line at one time so we can discuss your daughter's process and maybe we can learn some stuff like that. So first of all, give us your name and your daughter's name. You know, school she goes to. Give us a little bit of background.
Oh, wow. Well, thank you, Tracy, for coming on and for you guys and helping us out. Also, want to thank my best friend, Alonzo Shavers, for putting this together. I know he mostly works on football, and he speaks highly of your son, Sean, by the way.
Thank you.
I had to reach out to him because my daughter is a swimmer, and I'm like, I need help. I cannot find any good solid information on how to undergo this college recruiting process for swimmers. I too am used to football. Swimming was something new to me that, you know, we really had to learn and get into. So that's why he connects us together, so that he could, you know, begin to research and explore how the college recruiting process goes for swimmer and what do I need to do as a mother to prepare my daughter for this process. My name is Daryl Gentry, and my daughter is Leah Gentry-Tuney, and she's currently enrolled a junior in high school at Freedom High School in Orlando, Florida. And we took a leap of faith and came down to Florida because my daughter was aggressively pursuing swimming, and she connected with a coach through her mentor, who introduced her to Robbie Gaines, who was the vice president of aquatics down here at YMCA Central Florida. So that's how we got to Florida. So we're here, and we're into our third year, and quickly she advanced to becoming a national swimmer. She's currently second in the state for the 100 breaststroke, and she's been to Speedo Junior Nationals, and she's been to YNET. So she quickly advanced. So it was no joke. She's very serious about her craft and getting better and pursuing her dreams. So that's how we got down here, Tracy and Randy. So I thank you all for reaching out to us, and for Alonzo for putting us all together.
All right.
Go
ahead, Tracy.
Well, I was going to ask, I mean, does she have, like, a wish list of colleges that she's looking at?
Yes. So, Tracy, I don't know if you heard the part that my daughter is aggressive. She put this whole plan together to come down to Florida. She found her coach. She found where she wanted to train. And she was only 12 years old when she started this research. And, yes, she has a list of her top 10 colleges that she would like to go to. And she developed that list based on, one, her major, two, from the advice of her swim coach currently, based on what type of swim coach and swim program will best fit as a person she is. So that's how she created her list and how she prioritized.
So question, I got a question. So in football, this is how I hate to bring football to swimming when swimming is so much more elegant. But in football, if you had a top 10 list of schools, all we would do is go to the schools' camps. So like they have swimming camps for all these schools, right?
I don't even know. You know, this is, swimming is very new. So we're just starting to explore. She just started her junior year, and what I understand is that now we are allowed to do these unofficial visits and, you know, really begin grinding hard to get a high.
So what you say?
If I can chime in.
Go ahead.
What she really needs to be doing is she's able to contact the coaches now. So if she has, like, her top 10 list, she should be writing a letter to the coach saying, you know, here's my name, here's where I swim for, here are some of my accomplishments, here are some of the times. And it's a hard thing with swimming is there's so many year-round programs, and there's so many high schools here in Florida. And a lot of the Florida schools are, of course, going to offer looks nationwide. So it's hard for them to notice everybody. You kind of have to market yourself. That's the number one thing. I mean, you know, football, I know, stick with that. I mean, the different football, you guys, you know, you do a highlight reel.
Uh-huh.
We don't have that swimming. Sure. We don't have someone video recording our swim meets, and actually a lot of that's not allowed in FHSAA. So it's not like we're recording our swim and showing to the coach because they're interested in the times. That's what they're looking at. They're looking at the times. They want to see what your growth is. So maybe she wasn't a star athlete when she was a freshman or a sophomore, but then I see that she's all of a sudden dropped this time. And especially as a female swimmer, as a junior, that's where a lot of girls struggle. It's usually sophomore to junior year. So to know that she is now really raising the bar and elevating herself in the sport, that's going to pique the interest of a lot of coaches. Because usually this is the time where a lot of girls will plateau. And so if she is continuously developing and changing her stroke, but in the good sense, those coaches are going to be interested. So I always say to my athletes, never put yourself down. Never say, oh, I'm not good enough for a program, because you don't know what your worth is going to be next year. You know, and especially if you continue at the track you're at right now, you can drop so much time 1 year. I was making mention of one of our athletes that's out at FSU right now. He didn't even make it to the, there's a big meet that's called the Futures. And he didn't even have a Futures cut last year in the summer of his junior year. Didn't even have a Futures cut. To turn around in July, all of a sudden at practice start doing these, you know, kind of everything clicked through these times. And he's out on a scholarship at FSU right now. He was a state champion in the 100 freestyle, state runner-up in 50 free. So I always say to kids, don't ever discredit yourself. You know, if you keep that work ethic and let the coaches know, hey, I might not have been a strong swimmer when I was a freshman or sophomore, but here's what I've learned, here's what I've developed about my stroke. And, you know, keep an eye and an ear out for me. Here's what classification I swim in, here's what regional, here's my year-round program. And if a coach, if you kind of approach a coach like that, they'll kind of keep your name there on the sideline. You know, they'll keep a, they'll be like, well, I heard that name before, and they'll look you up. So that's always my first thing, is I tell athletes, you got to get yourself out there. They don't know to look for you, because they may not think you're interested in their program.
Yeah, so y'all don't, I mean, so swimming college coaches don't have DMs, because that's what we do. I mean, in other sports, we just, say if we're interested in Maryland, right? We type in Maryland on Google and then find out who the swimming coach is, first and last name. Either their email address should be on there, or they should have their Twitter address on there. If you got their Twitter address, you just send DMing them. Saying how, what kind of person you are, that you like their school, you always want to be whatever mascot they are, you always want to be whatever mascot or thing they have, and just and just have your stats attached to that. That's what we kind of do. So I mean, that's I don't know if that's like that in the swimming world, but that's what we do, because you got to market yourself. You got to. So did you?
Yeah. Well, I know like some of the things like with the USA Swimming, and like Tracy mentioned that FHSA, their rules are a little bit more stringent, like cameras and where you video and how you video. I mean, throughout her swimming career, we have captured some videos, and I've tried to do like a YouTube channel and stuff like that. But they're not really good angles, because, you know, sometimes you can't be on deck and you got to go here and there. And so,
and you can't be trying. You don't know which one is them.
Yeah, that's true too. Yeah. And then, you know, as a parent, you know, you get so excited and you're yelling, and so that's even hard too, because you're in the middle of your video yelling, go!
No, you can't do it.
So, you know, I don't think a coach wants to hear that, but, you know, we have tried all kind of things, and he has been blessed that we've had some coaches that have come up to her. Like, there was a coach last year that came up to her, I think it was Florida State, I don't know, but he was grabbing swimmers from across the state to go compete in Mississippi, so she was able to do that within her first year here. So she does have, like, different avenues. Like, she was able to go to Speedo Junior Nationals, she qualified twice for that, so she's getting the exposure, and people are asking her to come swim. But then how do you monopolize on that, and how do you make it be beneficial to her? I mean, we've gone and been invited to so many things, and beyond just club swim, beyond high school swim. But then what do you do with that, and how do you get that in front of people? That's the challenge I'm having right now. And honestly, I think we're on her junior year. She's been to state twice, she's placed twice, she's been second runner-up twice in a row. So it's like, now how come people aren't reaching out to us? I know in football, my little brother played football. He's about 16 years younger than me. And, like, coaches were looking for him when he was, like, a freshman in high school. And I'm like, well, why isn't it like that with swimming? You know what I mean? So I'm just trying to learn and just really trying to be an asset for her, so we're not missing the opportunities. And I think we're a little bit behind. So, you know, Alonzo has been there coaching and guiding as best as he can, and Randy, you know, he's the football guy, but he's like, you know, see, you and I, we got to learn this swimming thing, so we're all trying to do it and figure it out as best we can. But Tracy, she's had those opportunities. She's had other coaches come and look at her and say, hey, come swim with me on this state team, or, you know, she has gone to Speedo Junior Nationals. She has done all those things. So what do we do with that and from that point?
Well, the hardest thing, I think, first off, is, you know, don't fall in love with the romance. All the athletes are looking, just like you said, they're looking for the letters to be coming in. They want to be romanced. They want to, you know, see that someone's interested in them. And sometimes aren't always the best fit. Sometimes there's the programs are, you know, it depends where the offer's coming from. Sometimes it's just, they're going to take anybody, and they're marketing their name out there because they're so hungry for swimmers. And I think, you know, a lot of times the athletes, they want to have that signing ceremony. They're so used to seeing that at their high school. They want to be someone sitting there. It's what I go back to is, you know, number one thing you're going to college is you're going to college for an education. What are you wanting to be? Where are you wanting to go in life? And I would start there. What are the colleges you're interested in? You know, it'd be one thing if they're interested in being an Olympic athlete. It's another thing if you're looking to have a college, you know, tuition, you know, ride or assistance there. swimming is really difficult because, as from the best of my knowledge, there is really no full ride in swimming scholarship. It's not like because you're going to go, here you go, we're gonna pay everything. Typically, what they're going to do is, and I'm speaking on the state of Florida, having athletes go here in the state of Florida versus out of state. First number thing, they love that you live in Florida, and they're going to say, okay, what's your GPA? Are you eligible for the Fulbright scholarship, which is awarded their senior year? Are you eligible for a partial Fulbright scholarship? So if they're already getting financial aid assistance because of academics, it makes it easier for that coach to add on some money on the college recruitment side. I wouldn't worry about being late to the game as much right now, because junior year is really where it's going to happen with girls, and especially once they get post-state. As they're hitting regionals to state, that's when the offers and the calls are really going to happen. She may be, and we call them on the wipe-off board. So Florida actually has one of these. They have a wipe-off board with a couple years, and they may have someone's name on the wipe-off board, and they're waiting till the time that they can contact. And I know a couple of my junior boys are being contacted right now. It's like, hey, you know, we may be up north, but could you consider being out of state? So she may be on somebody's wipe-off board, and they just, like I said before, girls are real, it's really hard, you know, sophomore, junior, and senior with girls of what they go through and their changes and what happens with swimming. So a lot of times the offers are not going to come in right now in the beginning of the junior year, but as she gets closer to state and definitely post-state, those offers. And a lot of times it's not going to be, again, full ride. They're going to want to see where she is academically. What can she bring to the table? What can they get in their school? I mean, there's always some kind of president's award, some kind of leadership, maybe if she's going for a certain school of study, you know, if it's education, if it's criminology, things like that. Those certain college programs will also have scholarships. So if they're interested in your athlete, they will help you find the scholarships to pay for the tuition. The harder thing is when you go out of state. When you go out of state, a lot of times they're going to give you the amount of money so it's equivalent of you being in state. So if you're going somewhere out of state and it costs $20,000 a year, they can say, we can cut that down to 10. But you as a parent or her as a swimmer, where are you going to get that other 10 for her to attend that program? You know, and it's the name. A lot of in college, it's the name where you graduate from. I've had athletes loved Auburn. They've loved, you know, South Carolina, but they couldn't go out of state. They stayed here in state and swam in state because of the money that Florida could offer them or the scholarships they could get by being a Florida resident, going to a Florida university versus being an out-of-state, you know, college applicant. So it is, you know, it's half and half with the direction she wants to go in life and having to put the times up in the water, you know, this year. This is going to be a big year for her.
And also, I just want to remind you, too, you got to listen to the first part of this podcast, because you was right on track in a way of what we was talking about earlier. She was saying that most of the kids don't get those looks until after that state on that junior year and that senior year. But I like to remind you also, so for Division I, so we're talking about in Division I, they only give out 14 scholarships for a team that has maybe a swim team, female swim team that maybe have over 30-something swimmers on it. So sometimes, well, most of the times they split those scholarships up. So it's mandatory that you have everything else in order as far as your ACT, your GPA score, as high as it can go, so you can get other scholarships to add on to that to make a full scholarship. So that's
exactly.
So that's very, very important. So, like,
what I was saying earlier, you know, a program, you know, FS2 had an issue before when they were changing coaches. One coach had given so much tuition money away, they didn't have tuition money to offer their freshmen. They had freshmen they were interested in. It's not the current state now, this is a previous coach, but, you know, the money wasn't there because the juniors and seniors still had the money. So they had to wait till they graduated off to give them the money to the newer classes that were coming in. So it's looking at the roster and seeing how heavy the roster is at certain years. If they're really junior and senior now, the money might be there for her to be an incoming freshman. if they have allotted money for the freshmen and sophomores, it might be a little bit more difficult to get a scholarship to that. You don't get a vote. Is there a way to like know how many scholarships are available for like for instance, you know, she has her top 10 list of colleges she prefers to go to, and of course Florida is not one of them, but I'm trying to encourage her to stay in Florida. But how aware do you research, or how do you go about like finding which schools would have some scholarships available in swim? Because that's another thing. I did read somewhere where swimming scholarships are very slim. They may give out 10 a year, maybe, if that. So it makes the playing field really, really small and a little bit tougher to get those. So we could like get in front of it and identify these schools and find out, okay, well, FSU has 10 available, or there's 3 here, so this is what I got to do that. Like, where are those stats or that information? Is it NCAA, or like, how do we get that?
No, that's not NCAA, that's the coach. The coach know that. So Tracy, is that because in track that they said some coaches get mad when you do that? So is that the same thing? It doesn't matter whether they get mad or not. You're out for your daughter, so like don't worry about that. But what I'm trying to say, Tracy, is that something that they would like to answer? Would they answer? So for instance, if she has the time for Florida, so say she has the proper time for Florida in a couple of different events. All right, she calls Florida, DMs them, and say, I want to do a visit up there. We like you. They talk or whatever. They sit down in the coach's office, and she says, Coach, I mean, I just want to know how many what percent offers do you have available? Is that disrespectful?
You know, again, a lot of times they know, and most of the times when you sit there and you talk to a coach, and I know kids who have gone on their official visit, then that's usually where it's going to happen, that they can talk about those specifics. When they go on their official visit, they're going to say, look, I only have 3 spots I can get full rides to, or I have 3 spots. I'm waiting for an athlete up north in another state. If they're not going to take it, I'm going to split it into 2. So a lot of times, you know, you need to look at it going, if you're gaining 50%, it's going to be strong in swimming. Other things to look at is if you're willing to go to D2, Division 2, or Division 3. They don't have swimming scholarships, however, if they want you as an athlete, they will find the financial assistance for you.
Oh, yeah.
So it may not be called a swimming scholarship, but they have different programs where you come to our program, we can get you a scholarship, and, you know, but you're signing that you're going to, you know, commit to swim for us. I know, you know, quite a few swimmers from our area up here in Northeast Florida that have gone to schools in North Carolina and Georgia, all in the Southeast, on Division 2 full ride scholarships. They swam, they had to swim for the college, but their scholarship was never a swimming scholarship. It was always some other fancy language, like a Golden Green scholarship, you know, or
they have money. They have money allocated for athletes.
Yep.
So they have different programs.
That's something I never heard of before either. Like only Division 1 gives out swim scholarships. I didn't know that.
No. That's not true. So like for Division 2, they got 8.1 scholarships they give out. For NAIA, they got 8, and for junior college, they got 15. And
they won't give out full ride. A lot of those will be definitely split.
You're
just getting a little margin of money to swim for this program. Most of those programs will never give like a full ride.
That's why
they would rather fill up the roster. You know, so you think if you have like $10,000, if you want to give $10,000 to one athlete, or would you rather give 1,000 to 10 different athletes? That's how a lot of those schools, you know, look at it, and then they find the money to come in different ways
from other things. So let's kind of round this up to get to the point. So you got your 10 schools. What's going on, Frank?
I got one question for Coach. Coach, now basically, this is to a parent ask questions of that nature. Do you feel as if that the swimming coach should have the same type of insight or provide that insight? Because I'm thinking of parents or get like me. I have, like, my daughter may swim, right? I kind of want my daughter to be under a coach like you, who can give her the ins and outs of what's going on with this. Granted, Daddy's Ball here to help out as much as we can, but how is that common that it's not too many coaches that will give the recruiting insight to their athletes, or how does that go?
Well, I think it's two sides. You know, communication is always two ways. So as a coach, sometimes you always, you know, you really don't know if that athlete's wanting to swim in college. You may know the parent wants them to swim in college, but the athlete may not really want to swim in college. So it is finding that out. In high school swimming, sometimes it's just a staff member on the school who is a coach. They need somebody there to sponsor it, and your athletes are mainly coming from, you know, different year-round programs together. Some coaches are knowledgeable on it. Definitely your year-round coach should be knowledgeable on it. They should have different areas to go in. I know a couple of my athletes have also, there's recruitment agencies. There are different recruitment programs you can look out to. There's another website, collegeswimming.org. I recently was on it last week. Out of state, our program was ranked 8th. Even me as a coach, I'm ranked on the state with some kind of like, this is crazy.
Is it just Florida, or is it national?
You can see your athlete's name on there, and you can see where they're, when it comes to college. And I don't really know who's formulating this for our ranking, but they give your athlete a ranking, or they, it's totally different than USA Swimming. I mean, it's not affiliated with them.
Pretty cool.
And also, I don't know who asked that question, but I don't want to discredit Leah's coach. She has a phenomenal coach, and he does give advice and preparation. You know, we can have a meeting with him. I usually have a meeting with him probably like every 3 months, you know, just to see where she's at, what she's doing. Is she on the trajectory that we had mapped out, that we thought we would have? We do that quite often. And also, she was homeschooled when we first came down to Florida, because her swimming regimen was so rigorous. And that was part of his advice. Like, he coached us through that, and he helped us through that. He has a phenomenal coach. His name is Alan Sal. He came from SwimMAC in North Carolina. So he does do that, but, you know, my daughter's aggressive, and, you know, I'm a little overzealous too, so I want all the information. So, you know, and then with my friend Alonso having so many connections and just being in the sports world so much, I just always automatically turn to him like, hey, what do I do? And ever since she started swimming, he's been right there saying, okay, tell her to do this, next, and do this. Okay, now I'm going to find somebody for you to talk to. So I just think the more people we can get to talk to get it out, because honestly, absolutely, some of these swimmers down here have been swimming like since they were 5 or since they were 7, and still a lot of these parents still don't even know, like, okay, what do I do? What do I want my child to do next? My daughter and I, we like to be proactive. We like to really prepare. And especially for me, I guess I can't say it enough, I had no clue what swimming was all about, and all that was entailed, how technical it was, how costly it is. I didn't know any of those things. So we just, you know, we just came, you know. She said she had a dream, she wanted to pursue it. I told her to do what she needed to do, research, make sure it's what you wanted to do. She found your coach, we're going to go. And that's literally what happened. And so we don't want to stop that momentum. We want to keep going. So as much information that we can attain, and as many people we could connect with to make not just her dream reality, but everybody's dream, because a lot of us are new to this. We just don't know. And you can't actually, we don't rely on one person to give us everything, because Tracy, you've told me several things tonight that I've never even heard of. So I appreciate that.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah. That was the purpose of my question, not necessarily geared towards you and your situation. You know, it sounds like you all are blessed. She's already on the U.S. Olympic type thing.
Thank you.
right? But I was asking that question for people like myself who don't know anything about swimming. Like my kids are not even swimming yet, but could jump into the field of doing that or that sport. I wanted to know from, like, from her, from coach, is like, do you feel as if it's just, what I'm thinking is, I'm going to find a coach that knows what to do to offer my child the best situation or alternative for them. And I'm asking that question for other parents, not necessarily for you, but for more so for other parents that, like you said, you got kids that as soon as it's 5 years old, just don't know what to do and don't have the benefit of having somebody like you do to go to and ask these kind of questions, you know? Or don't get the guidance that they need.
No, that's absolutely correct. I do not know a thing about it. I will give all the credit, one of four, of course, to God for even getting us down here the way we did. But all the credit is to my daughter, Leah. She researched. She interviewed a couple coaches on her own to find out what she wanted, what she wanted to do, and what she wanted to pursue. There were two swimmers that she followed. One was Aaliyah Atkinson and the other one was Leah Neal. And Aaliyah Atkinson was like the first black woman, I believe, to get a world record in breaststroke. So Leah started with her, and her coach happened to be in Florida. So that's how she started her search for what coach was going to be best for her. So there's no way I could not support her with all that she has already put into making her own dream a reality. So I give her the credit for doing that research on her own.
And you're right, you have to figure out what coach you have.
She had to figure out what coach she wanted, what stroke she wanted to perfect, where she wanted to be. Like, she did all that starting at 12 years old.
All right, so I'm going to wrap this up a little bit before I let Miss Tracy kind of give me her last words for parents. So this is what I got. So just to kind of let you hear it at the same time, because I know I really would like for you to come back and listen to the podcast too, so you can give us some more hits. But just in case you don't, I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up, kind of everything we said. So it's better to be instead of being a master of one stroke, it's better to be a jack of all trades than a master of one. So you need to be good at least two strokes, and to be elite, you need to be good at all four. All right, we got that one, right? And we also said about your times. Like, you can go online and see whether your times are comparable to Division I, Division II, Division III, NAIA, or Junior College. So that's all online. All you got to do is type that in Google. You can see a lot of different sites that say, hey, if you don't have this time, you're not comparable to that type of athlete in college. All right? Then we talked about the way you can save money is by going in-state. Whatever state you're at, it's in-state tuition that'll help you out, because most swimming scholarships are not full scholarships. We talked about that. Then we talked about how you need to research the school, not just the swim team, the school, because you need to decide what kind of degree you want compared to being on that swim team. All right, we talked about that. Again, most schools don't get full scholarships. And reaching out to schools, letters, DM, give them all the information as far as your times, what school you go to, summer club that you're with that's outside of high school and stuff like that, so they can track you, and reaching out to them. That's your junior year. You're allowed to do that. They can't reach out to you at certain times, but you can reach out to them. And Twitter is like awesome for that. And we talked about the difference between and the importance of your junior year getting ready for state, because college coaches are going to be there, and those different club meets that are very imperative during your junior and senior year, where you have to show out and be ready at those times. Because if you practice swimming since you was 3 years old and you go to your state meet when you're a junior and you're not ready, you're probably not going to get the scholarship, because they just don't give it out. So you got to be ready. You got to get that time. You got to perform under pressure and all that kind of stuff. And I think that's it. But we're going to end everything with Coach Tracy. Let me know if I left something out, and just give me a closing thought for the parents out there that, you know, that want their kids to be swimmers in college.
Well, one last closing thought, I always have to say to my athletes is, social media is huge nowadays. Watch what you're saying.
as a coaching, will go back and look at your Twitter, your Instagram, your Facebook, and they want to see your character. They want to see what type of person you are. If they're going to spend money on you to swim in their program, they want to make sure that you're going to be there all 4 years and you're not going to be their headache. So, you know, there's that side of it, too, that, you know, make sure what you're saying and what you're carrying out and how you're carrying yourself is only the most positive way that you can. And, you know, because they need to see that you're coachable. So that's what we're looking at. And, you know, parents have to be involved. There's one thing of being supportive and definitely support your child, you know, in this journey as they're looking into college. It is very rough, you know, being an athlete in college. There's definitely perks to it. There's definitely fame and glory to it. But it is a rough life. That coach tells you what time you have to be at practice. You need to be there. What time you eat. And, you know, with all sports, so included, if you're injured, as a parent, you know, what's the fallback plan? Do you have the financial assistance for your child to continue going on to that school? Mm. Or are they going to be coming back home?
Okay.
So it's beyond just that little romance and that 6 months or year, or senior year, you're like, yeah, I'm going to this college, but you got to look at the full track and see what direction they want to go in life. And, you know, it's giving them the wings and preparing them to be out there in the world. I mean, your daughter is definitely fortunate that you guys were able to move and come down here and, you know, help follow through with that dream. And there's nothing more than a father and a mother's love, you know, and supporting a child in whichever direction they want to go into. So that's the biggest thing for parents, is just be supportive, be there, be an ear, because they will come and ask questions to you if you're open to hearing it. And, you know, they're still your little child.
All right.
Yeah, thank you for that. Thank you.
So I'd like to thank Coach Tracy. I'd like to thank Miss Daryl, this is probably the best podcast we did. I think so, man. What you thinking, Frank and Ralph?
Nice. Absolutely, dog. Absolutely.
Probably the best guy. Hey, we out. So.